Kalkados, how are you? I hope all is well. I wanted to share with you a beautiful idea that I saw on this week's parasha. Parashat Behaalotecha contains many stark contrasts. There's a lot of requests versus complaints, a lot of aspirations where we try to aspire to become better versus apathy, holiness versus desires and lust, rewards and punishments. The parasha symbolizes the story of the ascents and the descents, how we go up and down the ladder of the Jewish people in general and the Jew as a lone individual. From one side, we have Aharon, HaCohen. He receives the final instructions regarding the lighting of the Menorah, the Levi'im sanctifying themselves towards the service, Bnei Yisrael in the second year leaving Mitzrayim, leaving Egypt. They would like to do the Korban Pesach, the sacrifice, and they are unable to due to impurity. They were tememet. Some of them were impure because they touched the deceased bodies. And therefore, they weren't able to do it. So they asked, they requested from Hashem, we want another chance. And they were granted that other chance. The nation is traveling along with their banners and trumpets, each one's according to their tribes. But that was the good part of the parasha, which is the beginning of the parasha. And all of a sudden, on the other hand, everything changes. People start complaining for no reason. In response, they get burnt from Hashem. There was a fire that consumed a lot of the people. A mob that they started desiring different meats, and they start craving different types of fish and everything that they had in Mitzrayim, that they missed it. And again, they were inciting the people to go to the lowest level of materialistic levels. These stark contrasts, they remind us of the creation of the world. In Parashat Bereshit, at the beginning, we have a start which is healthy, glowing, creation of the world, the sun and the moon, inanimate objects. We have the plants, the animals, the humans, how Adam and Chava, they're living, right, in Gan Eden. And immediately afterwards, what do we see? All of a sudden, downhill. The sin of the chet etzadat, the sin of eating of this tree which was forbidden. All of a sudden, murder between brothers. And there was the different jealousy between them. All of a sudden, the decline of the world and everyone's going down. And therefore, Chachamim come and they teach us a very important yesod. This teaches us the conduct of human beings. Human life does not flow in a smooth course, but rather it's like a roller coaster. You go up, it has the ups and downs. And just like when we go on a roller coaster, we don't complain, and there will always be ups and downs, and people actually enjoy it. So too in life, we have to do the same thing. Life is like a roller coaster. There will always be ups and downs. The Volbe calls it Yemei HaMevuchim, the downs. Sometimes they're just days that we feel with no enthusiasm, with no oomph. And those days we have to act in a certain way, but be very, very cautious. But in every single person's life, and many times it can happen every single day, sometimes it can happen every single week, every month, every time, there's always ups and downs. When we're going to take an examination of the parasha, of the contents, we can find that no matter what, there's one channel, there's something that connects between the opposite parts that's written within. One of them is that you see a lot of times throughout the entire parasha, going from the beginning until the end, expressing dissatisfaction or discontent, showing that we are not happy and not accepting the present situation. We don't want to be in the situation where we are in it, whether it's on the individual level, the public level. Now, this attitude sometimes is positive, but sometimes it also has negative. And therefore, when the complaint was in the positive spirit, with goodwill and honesty towards Hashem, they got the right answer. However, though, on the other hand, when it was in the negative spirit, so then they got exactly what they deserved. Let's try to analyze, just to understand what we are trying to explain. The beginning of the parasha starts, speak to Aharon and tell him when you're going to light the nerot, the candles of the menorah. Rashi explains what is the connection between the menorah and the Nesi'im? Last week, Parashat Naso just finished with all the princes of the tribes bringing certain sacrifices. And immediately afterwards, the menorah. Why? Says Rashi, what happened was, is that once Aharon HaKohen saw the Nesi'im, saw the princes bringing their sacrifices, nechlasha chalsha dato, Aharon got a little bit discouraged. He was a little bit upset, just for a better word of it. And all of a sudden, he was nechlash dato, his mind wasn't with it. HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes and he tells Aharon HaKohen, what are you worried about? Chayecha, you should know by your life. Shelcha gedola mishlehem. Your job of the menorah is greater than their job. Shatam malikum etiv nerov, because you do the menorah. Rashi is based upon the Midrash, where the Midrash says that Moshe Rabbeinu told Aaron, HaKadosh Baruch Hu tells Moshe, tell Aaron, don't worry about it. You've got a greater thing. What is that? I gave everything because of the menorah. You have everything. But what exactly is going on? Why be'emet? Why in truth is Aaron upset? He doesn't realize that everything. The Ramban even asks a greater question. The Ramban Nachmanel, he says, I don't understand what Hashem is telling him. HaKadosh Baruch Hu could have told him, what, just a menorah? And we all know the menorah there refers to the Chanukiah. We're talking about the Chashmonaim, that were Kohanim, the Chanukah. Oh, 1 second. Aharon HaKohen goes, he's the only one. Every single day he brings the Ketoret. We know this incense, it stops from plagues. That's why it's a Sibulah now to say it all the time. We have the incense stops the Malach HaMavet, the angel of death. We have, he's the only one that goes in Lifnai V'Lifnim to the Kodesh HaKodeshim. He goes inside the Kodesh HaKodeshim on Kippur, the entire service. You know how many things that he does? Everything goes to the Kohen Gadol. He's not going to be upset or jealous or something of something which is so minute, a one-off sacrifice. What exactly is going on? Answers the Ramban, listen to his words. He says, you know why? The Korbanot of Aharon HaKohen were an obligation. And he was a little bit upset because the Nesi'im were giving it as a present. And the inauguration of the Mizbeach, inauguration of the Mishkan, they were bringing it as a present of goodwill to Hashem. It wasn't they were obligated to do so. And therefore, how do we understand this? Obligation, present, what's going on? And therefore, explain Chachamim something incredible. Listen carefully. We know what was really bothering Aharon HaKohen deep inside. You know what was bothering him? He had a yearning. He had such a strong yearning and such a strong eagerness to always serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu and to fulfill his world, his role in this world. And therefore, he gave everything, utmost devotion to it. As the Torah says also in this parasha, but Yasken Aaron did it. Well, he didn't. He obviously did what Hashem wanted. Melamed shelo shina, he never changed. He did it with the same enthusiasm. Just like when a bar mitzvah boy puts on tefillin. Look at a bar mitzvah boy. When he puts on tefillin the first time, he does it slowly. He counts it. He does it with all the eagerness. Look at a person after 10 years. Boom, on, off. You don't even realize he put it on. You don't even know. He's going automatic. It's incredible when you learn how to drive. You ask a person that learned how to drive manual transmission. How do you do with the clutch and this? Which one do you do first? Which one do you do second? They don't even remember. It became in their subconscious so much they don't pay attention anymore. But they became accustomed to it. Aharon HaKohen wasn't like that. Every single action that he did it with a love, with an eagerness, with a devotion to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And therefore he went and he said, 1 second, HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He wasn't because they brought their sacrifices. It doesn't say because he brought it. But he knew that they brought it. Kishira'ah. When he saw such a light coming, he yearned to become closer to Hashem. So for him, he says, I also don't only want the obligations. I would want to bring a present to Hashem as well. And therefore, HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes and he says, Aaron, this is what you want. I'm going to give it to you. Don't worry about it. The reason why you don't have it is not because you weren't fitting or you're not at the level. The exact opposite. You're above that. You're on such a higher level, you could only get better things. So don't think that you're going downwards, the opposite, because you're craving and you're yearning for the positive, to become better. Listen to this. We all know that the Shulchan Aruch Maran of Yosef Karo, he's the Balapos, he's the Posek of everything that we have. We have the Shulchan Aruch, all halakha is based on him. The Ramah, Rabbi Moshe Isulis, is for the Ashkenazim. He wrote notes on the Shulchan Aruch. Wrote an appendix, something, abbreviations on the side, little notes. Do you know the story behind it? The Ramah wanted to do this exact same work as the Bet Yosef on the tour. The tour preceded the Shulchan Aruch, and he wrote the halachot, but it was too much at length. Shulchan Aruch wanted point by point. Very short, sweet, and to the point. Halacha. So the Darkei Moshe starts writing it, and all of a sudden the Bet Yosef comes, and he precedes him. So he stopped. Now, okay, so he writes the Darkei Moshe, which is again another Sefer. But then all of a sudden he comes, and when he sees what happens with the Shulchan Aruch, he comes and he says something incredible. He says, "Az nivhalti shepo alarik palti. Maybe I worked in vain. Everything that I did, the Bet Yosef was a much better job than what I did. So really, be'emet, I feel myself lowered that I didn't do it." So what happened? He comes and he decided to actually add on to it. And then he comes and also the same thing with the Shulchan Aruch. He adds on his own notes to the Shulchan Aruch. HaKadosh Baruch Hu accepted it. And for the Ashkenazim, he is the bottom line. He is the psak halacha, what they paskin. What happened exactly? The Ramah, Rabbi Moshe Isulis, he understood. Let's analyze what his actions were. Maybe some of us would get upset. We would start trying to put them down. Start stopping the dissemination of the work. Start saying, you know what, it's not good. Look at the flaws. Look at this. He didn't do that. He only recognized and he said, you know what? Chaval, you know, why couldn't I have that merit to fulfill this role, to fill this vacuum in the world? I looked at it myself, but now I want to become better. I wasn't just jealous of the other person. I wasn't trying to put him down. I wasn't trying to do anything negative. It was something positive. If you go in the positive, you will get answered positively. This care, how much a person yearns and really is eager to do the mitzvot, the exact same thing happened immediately afterwards in the parasha. Pesach Sheni. What was Pesach Sheni? We had people that were Tamemet. Who are these people? Rabbi Akiva says in Mesechet Sukkah, Daf Kafei Amud Bet, says Rabbi Akiva, Mishael Vel Tzafan, the children of Uziel, family members. They came and they buried Nadav Avihu. They were the ones taking care of the burial of Nadav Avihu, that they were killed, obviously in Parashat Shemini, by the children of Aharon HaCohen. What happened was, is all of a sudden they come to Moshe Rabbeinu and they say, Moshe Rabbeinu, Lama Nigara, we also want to be a part of it. It hurts us that we can't do mitzvot. It hurts us that we can't come and bring a Korban Pesach. Moshe Rabbeinu comes and he says, Imdu Veshmal, what does that mean? Stand and you're going to hear like a student, says Rashi, that is a certain from his master. Moshe Rabbeinu saw, you care. You really yearn. You want to truly become better. You're aspiring to become better. Not just because you're complaining on a negative sense. You want to become better people. I'm a certain HaKadosh Baruch Hu will give it to you. And he was answered in the affirmative. We have Pesach Sheni. Pesach Sheni teaches us it's a makeup. You never lose. You could always make everything up. And if you think about it, throughout the entire Torah, halacha, everything you see it. Pesach Sheni, you could always fix it. A person misses a tefillah, it's just tefillah tashlumin. Make it up. Korbanot, when you come up to do aliyah leregel, when you used to come to the Bet HaMikdash, shalosh regalim on the chagim, you would be able to make it up. You didn't bring it on the first day, you could continue bringing it later. The entire concept of Judaism was always based upon making it up. It's not never an end pasuk. It's never that you just finish and that's it. It's not a dot. Continue. Because if you yearn to grow, you'll be able to grow. All of a sudden, Moshe Rabbeinu continues. And all of a sudden, people start complaining. Moshe Rabbeinu says to Hashem, Hashem, how could it be that I have the yoke of everybody, the entire Klal Yisrael on my shoulders? It's too much. Why don't we give it to divide it between different people? So HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes, and what does he tell him? You're right. Why? Because you did it. You didn't complain about the situation in a negative fashion. You were looking for the best of the Am Yisrael, and therefore immediately gather for me the 70 people, the 70 elders, and we're going to put them in charge of the different facets that Bnei Yisrael actually need. Immediately after that, we have the story of Eldad and Medad, half-brothers of Moshe Rabbeinu. And these half-brothers of Moshe Rabbeinu, they resisted, they went down, they stepped down. And therefore, they received the nevuah, they received prophecy that Moshe Rabbeinu, their brother, was going to pass away and Yeshua would bring them in. Gershom, the son of Moshe Rabbeinu, he was hurt. What, they're going against my father? Yeshua, the student of Moshe Rabbeinu, tells Moshe, Adoni Moshe, kilaim, kill them, put them in jail, whatever the explanation of that words mean. What does Moshe Rabbeinu answer? He says, what? Hamkaneatali? Are you jealous for me? It's not for my honor. It's for Hashem. Everything is supposed to be done for Hashem. I don't mind. Let them do that. Tell me that everyone should be like that. But now all of a sudden, let's try to focus on the other way. On the negative way. Whether it is the negative of complaining and the negative of being discontent or not happy with what the situation is. All of a sudden we have Ayyam Mitonanim, people, they're coming, they're complaining. About what? The Sforno says, Kemitonanim. Why Kemitonanim? They were like complaining, but there's nothing what to complain about. Imagine right now, your clothing, you never have to take it to the dry cleaners. Your clothing, you never have to buy things. There's no Amazon. You don't need anything in the desert. Everything grew with you. Food comes down in a shamayim. Everything that you needed was taken care of. You didn't need to work. You didn't need to do nothing. What are you complaining about? They were complaining because they wanted to distance themselves from Hashem. They didn't want. They didn't want this closeness. So all of a sudden, what happens? Immediately, they get punished. And therefore, what happens, and that's what happens throughout the parashah that you see, whether it was there or whether it was that they were running away from Harashem, in all the cases in the parashah where you see that they are not happy, but it's in the negative light, all of a sudden you see that there's a punishment immediately right afterwards. Even Midyama Neviyah at the end of the parashah, when she spoke Lashon Hara against her brother, it was not 100% correct. And therefore she was punished. And she also got leprosy. And therefore, Chachamim come and they say that the Yesod, the fundamental understanding that we have to understand from this parasha is as follows. Many times we are discontent. Many times we're not happy with the current situation. Especially look around us now. You think people are happy? Whether it's with the economy, whether it's being stuck at home all day, whether it's the children that they can't go and flourish and learn, right, in a normal environment. Socially, we can't go anywhere. We can't do anything. I'm sure people could be discontent right, left, and center. People could be depressed. They could be not happy. They could be everything that you want. We have to understand one thing. Where is it coming from? Where is the roots deep down coming from? Every single time that we're not happy, every single time that we complain, every single time that we are discontent, focus on one thing. Let us ask ourselves the question. And the question has to be, is it positive? Or is it negative? Is it we are not happy because we want to continue growing? We want to be coming close to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's in the positive light, which is constructive. So then it's actually good. And we will get answered in the affirmative. We will get answered positively. If Chas V'Shalom, it's the other way around. And it's in the negative. And we're just complaining for complaining. Chas V'Shalom, we have to be very, very careful. Why? Because we never gain from complaining in vain. We know that in next week's parasha, which is also Shalach, which they actually read in this Shabbat, there's an incredible Yisod brought down to do with that we cried in vain. And since we cried in vain, that's what happened. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, after the Meraglim, the spies, and they said, you guys cried in vain on Tisha B'Av, I'll give you a reason to cry every single Tisha B'Av. For the negative, we get answer negative. Again, by human nature, we always have to try to aspire to become closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But we have to always, sometimes, many times, we come and we're not happy with the situation. That's permitted. Always as long as we are always yearning to become closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. If it's always in the positive light, Bezrat Hashem, we could actually get it to the positive. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu will answer us. Bezrat Hashem, here nowadays we're always put in a very difficult test. Everyone's put in a difficult test. It could be from anything, whether financially, whether it's spiritually, whether it's tefillot. We're not happy. But why are we not happy? Are we not happy because we can't do chesed with each other? So then we could try as much as we can to try to do chesed in other ways. Is it happy because we can't really pray in a minyan like a normal human being? So let's try to aspire that. Pray more with kavanah. Go make sure that we make up the tefillot. We go to the tefillot and we already have minyanim open. So let's go. Let's make sure that we're strengthening it. Kirusha bet haKnesset, right? The holiness and the spirit of the bet haKnesset. All these things, pay attention to. Why? Because if it's always for the positive, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will always answer us for the positive. Bezerat Hashem, we should be able to be zocheh to Mashiach's kingdom, amen, amen, and all the berachot, Bezerat Hashem. Enjoy, Shabbat Shalom, and we miss you a lot. Kol Tov, Batzacha.